In the last class, we saw that one nice way of handling or understanding the stability of orbits, closed loop orbits, would be to express it in discrete time, which means if there is an orbit like so, then we would place a Poincare section and we would observe the successive piercing through the Poincare section. So, this is the Poincare section. Now, if then you look at the orbits starting from an initial condition somewhere away, what will you observe? It will go through cycles like this, but since this is a, supposing this is a stable periodic orbit, then you would see the successive piercings homing onto the equilibrium point, which means on the Poincare section you will see a sequence of points that converge onto this particular point. Okay. And that gives us a nice way of understanding the stability of orbits. That is why this method of Poincare section is very widely used. So, we started from equations of the form x dot is equal to f of x, these are vectors, and we arrived at equations of the form x n plus 1 is equal to function of x n, these are vectors. We had also understood that the description in discrete form is one dimensional less than the description in continuous domain. This original, as I have depicted, the original state space was 3-dimensional, but when we have obtained everything on the Poincare section, it is just 2D. So, we have a sequence of points that ultimately would converge onto this. So, we are trying to analyze the character of this set of equations from now onwards. So, from now onwards, we will essentially concentrate on discrete time dynamical systems, because mostly for convenience sake, dynamical systems theorists essentially concentrate on this, meaning that we are actually handling equations of this form. But having reduced this form, it is easier to handle, is easier to understand, and it is easier to analyze. So, we have okay, you might say that how to place this Poincare section. For example, you might say that it is say somewhere here, you might put it somewhere here. If it is somewhere here, then obviously the orbit does not pierce this Poincare section. So, that would be considered a invalid placement of the Poincare section. So, Poincare sections would be, the placement is in your hand, there is no hard and fast rule. The only rule is that there must be a transverse intersection of the orbit, of all the motions of the orbit with the Poincare section. If there were more than one, for example, if the orbit were something like this, then somewhere you have to place so that all the loops intersect this. So, you need to place the Poincare section somewhere here, so that all the loops intersect it. So, that is condition, one condition. Second condition is that if you extend this Poincare section here, it is after all not ending here. I have only shown it ending here just as a way of illustration, but it is actually a plane that extends. So, what happens here? Now, this point needs to be disregarded, because this is not after one full cycle of observation. So, even if it pierces here, you have to observe only the piercings from one direction. Only this one will have to be observed, not this. So, that is point number 2. there are some rules of placement of the Poincare section. So, ultimately you will do this. You might ask, for a given physical system, you coming from various backgrounds may encounter different types of physical systems. Some of you may be from electrical engineering, you will have a physical system that is electrical. Some of you may be coming from mechanical engineering, there will be physical system that is mechanical. Also, there could be chemical systems, there could be many types of systems, biological systems, and each will have some kind of description in this form. Okay. How to actually reduce it into this form? Conceptually, it is easy to find, but how to actually obtain this? In general, this has to be obtained from here through numerical means, because starting from an initial condition, say here, you will have to evolve or solve this set of differential equations to obtain the next piercing. Can you just close it properly? Till the next piercing, and then only you know that this point is mapping to this point. So, you have to start from an initial condition that is on the Poincare plane, and then you have to evolve the whole set of differential equations till you pierce the next time from the same direction. Now, this being a set of nonlinear differential equations, therefore, you will normally not have the advantage of having a explicit solution. Nonlinear equations will have to be solved by numerical means, fourth order Runge-Kutta method or something like that, which means that starting from an initial condition on the Poincare plane, you will have to apply a numerical method to obtain this whole orbit and wait for the condition when there is another piercing. When that happens, this point is stored. So, effectively this whole thing becomes a subroutine in which you start not just anywhere, you start from a point on the Poincare plane, and then it calculates the whole orbit till it that the program to detect the next piercing also has to be embedded in that subroutine. So, having done all that, there is a chunk of code, that whole chunk of code becomes your map. So, when I say f, this f may not be a explicitly given function. It can be some kind of implicit thing whose actual expression will be in the form of a chunk of code. So, when you want to evolve such a thing, you will not start from any initial condition, you will start from the Poincare section and go on evolving. So, what happens? The evolution goes like this: that chunk of code starts with some initial condition on the Poincare plane, and then the chunk of code is evolved. The final condition becomes the initial condition again for the same chunk of code. So, you put it onto your for loop and that goes on, and that is how this is called a map. As I told you, the map is obtained from a practical continuous dynamical system. Even though the map has to be obtained by that kind of a numerical procedure, often we can do a lot of analysis with it. How? Because the map often will be found to share certain characteristics with some maps whose functional forms we know, and therefore, by analyzing the character of those functional forms, we can infer a lot of importance about many practical dynamical systems. I will come to that slowly. Okay, so, let us illustrate some of the cases where you do have the advantage of being able to obtain an explicit map. Oh, 1 minute. This is a system which I wrote in this form, and in that we assumed that there is no time dependence in the right hand side. The right hand side is independent of time. For example, look at the equations in your copies, equations of the Lorentz system. You will find that there is no time dependence, okay, there in the right hand side. Such systems are called autonomous systems. So, if the equations of this form x dot is equal to f of x without time dependence then they're called autonomous system. If your x dot is equal to function of x and t, then it will be called a non-autonomous system. Have you come across any example of a non-autonomous system? The force pendulum, right, where there is a periodic forcing, we have seen that, right. So, that is a typical example of a non-autonomous system, and a typical example of an autonomous system is a loaded system. So, you have understood that. Now, while I was talking about the Poincare section, what I meant by this set of equations was a set of autonomous equations. So, how to do this for non-autonomous system, I will come to that, that will need to be understood. But one thing should be clear, that the asymptotically stable orbits, if it is a period 1, what do you see on the Poincare plane? Just one point. If it is a period 2, what do you see on the Poincare section? Just 2 points. If the system is period 3, 3 points. If the system is period infinity, infinity of points, right. So, that is why I said there is a 1-to-1 correspondence between what you see in the actual state space trajectory and what you see on the Poincare plane. Only you have to infer that way, that if I see one point as a stable periodic orbit, stable point, then it is a periodic orbit, 2 points period 2 orbit, 3 points period 3 orbit, and if it is infinity of points, it is a chaotic orbit. Now, let us come to the situation of the non-autonomous system. In a non-autonomous system, there is some kind of a periodic forcing. Okay. A periodic forcing itself comes back to its the forcing itself. If it is sinusoidal forcing, the sinusoidal variation, the magnitude of the sinusoid comes back to itself after 2 pi. Okay. And therefore, in that sense, you might say that here is my, say it is a 2D system with a sinusoidal forcing. Say this is my time axis and this is say a x coordinate. In order to draw it easily, I am showing just one variable, okay, one dimension, and here is the time axis. For all practical purposes, then I can say that the time 0 is the same as time 2 pi, because the sinusoidal forcing comes to the same one. In that sense, what you can visualize this as a sheet of paper which is rolled and it goes there and becomes like so, 0 becomes equal to 2 pi, which means that a non-autonomous system's state space is actually on the surface of a cylinder. The state space of a non-autonomous system is like the surface of a cylinder. So, you would say that it is something like this. Now, on this you have some dynamics going on, right. And now I want to do something which will in effect be like placing a Poincare plane, with the condition that all orbits must intersect it. What is the most natural way of placing the orbit? Simply cut the cylinder. Okay. So, the nice way of placing the Poincare plane would be just here, which means that physically what does it mean? You have to observe it after every 2 pi, okay. physically you have to observe it after every 2 pi, that's it. I have drawn it with one state variable another time. Imagine there are n number of state variables, then also the situation remains the same. If there are n number of state variables, you still keep on observing every 2 pi, and thereby what you get is the map. Is that clear? But notice one thing, that in case of the autonomous system, you had reduced the system dimension by 1, right? You had reduced the system dimension by 1, but here the system dimension that was 1, here also it remains the same. There was a time coordinate that was actually effectively working like a variable which you have sampled, and therefore the spatial variables, the state variables, they remain the same. So there is no reduction in the number of dimension, number of state variables. Thirdly, another point needs to be taken into account. Suppose there is a non-autonomous system, how would you define its periodicity? A non-autonomous system like so, how would you define its periodicity? That you are discretely observing at every twice pi, and if the state variables, they come back to the same state after twice pi, you say it is period 1. If it comes back to the same state after twice 4 pi, then it would be period 2, and so on and so forth. So the periodicity then should be counted not by the number of loops in the state space, but by the number of periodicities of the forcing function that are there inside one period of the state variable. Yes, there can be situations where these two can be in conflict. Let me illustrate. Suppose you have got a 3D state space like this, and suppose you have an orbit like this. What will you call it? You will call it normally a period 1 orbit. But now suppose this fellow is occurring in a non-autonomous system, so that if you observe it at every twice pi of the forcing function, then you observe it here and here. What is the periodicity of the system then? 2, because in this whole cycle there are 2 cycles of the external forcing function within one cycle, and that is why you would call it period 2. So just the visual appearance does not always say the right thing. In case of non-autonomous systems, therefore you have to take some additional caution. You have to be a bit careful. The definition is, remember, the definition of periodicity in a non-autonomous system is the number of external, the number of periodicities of the external forcing function within one period of the state variable. But then, in many systems you will find that the external periodic function, that means the fact that the system is non-autonomous, offers some additional advantage. Let me illustrate one case. Some of you are from electrical backgrounds, this might sound familiar. There are a class of switching circuits to DC to DC converters, and say let me draw one very representative DC to DC converter. You have got a source here, you have got an inductor here, and you have got a switch here, and here you have a diode, and then a capacitor, and finally the load. This is a load, normally a resistive load. this is normally called a boost converter. Why boost? For those who are in electrical engineering, that is trivial. For those who are not, let me briefly explain. The switch is turning on and off periodically, it is a switching circuit. So, it is switching, turning on and off. When it is on, then you can say it is simply this circuit, a voltage source connected with the inductance. What will be the behavior? It will ramp up, okay. It will ramp up. So, it will ramp up at what slope? L d I d t is equal to input voltage, right. So, d I d t is equal to the slope V in by L. When it switches off, then what happens? Then the whole circuit is in place, right. And naturally, this energy stored in the inductor will now go to the load. While it does so, the current falls. So, the current falls means now the polarity must become like this, because the current is falling, and the polarity of the V in was like this. So, you see the voltage across the inductor acts in addition to the input voltage to be applied on this capacitor. So, the capacitor will see a voltage that is in excess of the input voltage, and that is why it boosts the voltage. So, output voltage will be larger than the input voltage, okay. That is why it is called the boost converter. Good. Now, often the purpose of such a circuit would be to keep the current within limit, to keep the output voltage constant. So, these are often done. There is a loop called the current mode control loop, which I will not draw the loop itself, but I will explain what it does. Suppose this is the 0 value for the current, and here I am drawing the current axis, current through the inductor. So, this current is my I. There is a reference value of the current I ref, and there are some clock instants. That means there is a free running clock going, and it is generating the clock instants. The switch turns on at every clock, so that at this instant it is a clock instant, I will expect the switch to turn on, right. And it will ramp up, fine. When it reaches I reference, it switched off, as simple as that. So, it will again ramp down. Again at the next clock instant, it will turn on. So on and so forth. That is a simple way it works. The current mode control logic, essentially it is called peak current mode control, it works. It does not allow the current, inductor current, to exceed a certain value, and that is how it works. Now, suppose in fact you have the people who work in this field know that this circuit goes unstable for certain conditions, but let us see how we can analyze it from this angle. I have drawn it more or less like straight lines. Do you know why? Because during switch on, it is logically a straight line. If you ignore the resistance in this inductance, it is fine. It is quite right to draw a straight line because of this equation, d I d t is equal to constant. But during the switch off, it is not right to do so, because now it becomes a LCR circuit. Can you see? L C R. So, it will be a normally a damped sinusoid kind of solution. But if this clock period is far smaller than the characteristic time of that LCR circuit, then obviously the small sinusoidal segment can be approximated by a line, and that is why these things are also very closely approximated by straight lines. It is not very wrong. That happens if this capacitor is large enough. The capacitor is large enough so that the variation of the voltage here, the ripple here, is kept to a minimum, so that you can assume some kind of output voltage, you can assume. This is the ground. If you assume the output voltage to be constant, then you can easily see that the current through the inductor will ramp down as a straight line. What will be the slope, down slope? If I call the up slope as m1 and down slope as m2, this is m1 and down slope as is. So, V out minus V in, remember V out is larger than V in by L, will be the down slope. All right. Now, this is a continuous time dynamical system. Here it goes following some kind of a continuous path, here it comes following some kind of a continuous path, but is it an autonomous system or a non-autonomous system? It is non-autonomous, because even though I did not put a sinusoidal forcing function, nevertheless it is non-autonomous, because there is a clock, some kind of external forcing. Wherever there is external forcing, it is a non-autonomous system. And in non-autonomous system, therefore, we have to observe it at every clock instant. So, we will have to observe it here, so on and so forth. Okay. So, we are trying to express essentially when we want to observe the map is I n plus 1, where this is the n plus 1th instance, say this is the nth instance, say this is n plus 2 instance, say plus 3 and so on and so forth, is equal to some function of I n. That is what you are trying to obtain. Now, can we obtain it? Let us see. I will put it here so that you can see this part. Can you see on the screen? Yeah. Now, you start from IN, and reach I reference. How much is the time elapsed? IN plus M1 T on, the on period is this much, is equal to I ref. This yields T on is equal to fine, and the final value I n plus 1 is I ref minus this. So, I ref minus m2 t of period, which is I ref minus m2 t minus t on. Okay, t is constant because it is the clock period is constant, and t on is this much. So, we have I ref minus m2 t plus m2 times this fellow. Fine. Can you simplify this? You will get a constant part this is your constant part minus this is the variable part, depends on IN. So, you see what we have achieved is IN plus 1 has been expressed as a function of IN. This is the map, this is the discrete time dynamical system. Okay. Not very difficult though, right? Not very difficult at all. there is a bit of complication here, because it might so happen that one orbit may go like this. Say it starts from here and it goes like this. It does not reach the I reference before the next clock. That is also possible, obviously. So, if the current at this clock instant is below a certain value, that certain value is given by the situation where it reaches exactly the next clock. If it is below, it will follow like this. If it is above, then it will go like this. And the condition for going like this has been obtained. Can you obtain for the condition for going like this? Simple, really. I will again do this in the lower part here. Going from here to here. So, I n plus 1 is equal to I n plus m 1 upslope times the full period. M 1 is upslope times the full period t. Okay. So, this will happen, this will be the map for this kind of evolution, and the other one will be the map for this kind of evolution. And this is separated by this condition, that is kind of a borderline condition, critical condition. What is the critical condition? I border is, I border is, how will you get it? You will say I border plus m 1 capital T is equal to I ref. Okay. So, I border is equal to I ref minus so you see all that we obtain is that here the discrete time dynamical system is composed of two parts, either it will be like this or it will be like that, and whether or not you have to take this function or that function depend on whether it is below or above this. The implication and other things of this I will come to later. I will preserve these pages so that we can come back to this later. So, you see here was a system in which we could obtain a one dimensional description I only. We did not need V, because we made the assumption, where is it? Yeah, we made the assumption this that the capacitor is large, so that the capacitor voltage does not fluctuate much. If you relax that, you will get a two dimensional description, but it will be slightly more complicated, and we did not want to get into that complication today. But in general, it is not very complicated though. The point then is that in many dynamical systems, it is possible to reduce that into one dimensional map in the form of x n plus 1 is equal to some function of x n, where x is a scalar now. 1D means I am not no longer talking about x as a vector, it is a one dimensional thing. The major advantage of this a one dimensional map is that the graph is visualizable, the graph is drawable, you can draw. For example, take this function x n plus 1 is equal to this is a very famous equation in fact called the logistic map. It was made famous by a man called Robert May. He wrote a paper in 1976 in Nature, in which he was a population dynamicist. That means he worked on population dynamics. Imagine the population of fish in a pond. The more suitable the environment of the pond is, the more will be the population of that pond. It will tend to increase, and the more it will increase, in the next generation, it will not be able to increase further. So, higher the population, it will have to have a feedback effect on the population in the next generation. And the fish population actually increase in the breeding times, and therefore, it is really discrete time dynamical system. So, the discrete time dynamical systems occur in various possible ways. One is to obtain the Poincare map that I showed, but there are various possible ways. For example, the internet packet transfer, how does it happen? They happen always in discrete packets, right? So, if you want to keep track of the number of packets being transferred, this is a number that goes discretely, changes discretely, a discrete time dynamical system. Similarly, populations are discrete time dynamical system. And this is the model he proposed to map a single species population, something like the population of one species of fish in a pond, feeding all algae or something like that. Now, the more suitable that particular pond is for that fish, that means the more the feed and other environmental factors, the more will be the factor mu. So, this is a parameter. This is a parameter in the system that actually models how suitable the environment of that pond is to the particular fish. And x n represents the population in the nth generation. So, you can quickly do an exercise. Do you have calculators? There are certain things you can do by hand. There are certain things you can do better by calculator. Suppose you start from any value of x n with mu set to 0.1, for example. Set mu to 0.1 and start from any value of x n, say 0.6. By the way, mu x n is normalized between 0 and 1. That means x n is equal to 1 represents something like a maximum possible population in that pond. So, start from mu is equal to say the parameter, set the parameter at 0.1, and x n you start from any initial value, say 0.6. See what happens. It will very fast decay and the population will be extinct. Check out. Does it not? Increase it to say 1.2. Increase mu to 1.2. You will find that it does not do so easily. It takes more time, but ultimately it does decay, right? Can you check? It will be a good exercise for you to do this for different values of mu. You can do this by a calculator. In fact, the first people who analyzed this did so by hand. They did not have even access to calculators, but you might use a calculator and check out what will happen to this population. That means, first you start from 0.6, that will give you a some population x n plus 1, that you put as x n, that will give you the next generation population x n plus 2, put that as x n, that will, so that goes on, you get a sequence. If that sequence converges to some number, then you know that is the stable behavior. Now, you note in this case that for 0.1 it converges to 0, and at some larger value it converges not to 0, but to some stable population. You would notice that for even if you increase it even further, say 3.1, it does not really convert to a particular value. Rather, in the steady state, it keeps on toggling between two values. That means, 1 year it is small number, next year it is large number. Again, next year it is small number, next year it is again large number. So, it will toggle between two possible values. Increase it even further, it goes to period 4. So, all that that you have seen happening in our example systems earlier are actually mimicked by such a simple equation. And simple equation, if you can understand the mechanism in a simple equation, there is nothing better than that. So, we will do exactly that. We will try to understand why that happens using this map, okay. And that will be a rather simple route to take. We have already seen that this is what happens in the differential equation systems that we have taken. We have seen that in the Lorentz system, we have seen that in the Rösler system, we have seen that in the driven pendulum, we have seen this particular kind of sequence. Okay, now the main advantage, as I told you, is that a map can be drawn. This functional form can be drawn. How? For example, this one, can we infer what will be the character of this? I will draw x n versus x n plus 1. Can you draw? Easily, because if I take x n is equal to 0, its value is 0. If I take x n is equal to 1, its value is still 0. Okay. So, this point will be 0 at x n equal to 0, x n plus 1 must be 0. At x n is equal to 1, x n plus 1 should be again 0. And therefore, there has to be a peak somewhere in between. Okay. If things are 0 at 2 points, it is reasonable to expect that there will be a peak somewhere in between. Have you heard of the famous theorem by Dirac? A famous theorem by Dirac. In one of the parties, he discovered a theorem that the distance from which a woman's face looks the best, there is always a maxima there. His logic was, if he she is at an infinite distance, you don't see the face, it's a dot. If you see it at zero distance, you again don't see it. See, in between there must be a maxima. So that is how Dirac wanted to theorize everything. But here also we can logically say that there would be a maxima. Okay. Now, the moment you draw this, a few things become immediately clear. When I say that it ultimately goes and stabilizes somewhere as a stable steady state behavior, what does it mean? X n is the same as x n plus 1, is same as x n plus 2, is the same as x n plus 3, and so on and so forth. How can you find that out? That is the condition when x n plus 1 is equal to x n. That is a fixed point. So, that is a fixed point of this map. You can easily find out the fixed point here. Can you find it? Yes? Yes. So, you will put x n star. The fixed points are generally denoted with a star, is equal to mu x n star 1 minus x n star. Obviously, the solution would be 1 at mu x n equal to 0. Okay. So, a solution would be x n star is equal to 0 and no, not 1. This I didn't calculate. Let me calculate. Come on. It will be mu minus 1 minus, yeah, you can write it this way. Now, a nice way of representing this is simply to draw the 45-degree line. Any point on this 45-degree line will have this property, and therefore, where it intersects the graph of the map, this point will be the fixed point. So, this is one way of calculating. Again, this will also be a fixed point. Okay. Now, when I say that take a calculator and start from an initial condition, say x n is equal to 0.6, and keep on iterating, what you will do? You will put a 0.6 here, 0.6 here, calculate this, put it here, again put it in the left hand side. That way you go on iterating it. That iteration can then be done graphically. How? You would say that, say here is my 0.5 and say I start from say 0.4. If my initial condition x n is 0.4, where will the x n plus 1 be? I have to go up vertically and cut here. So, I will go vertically up and reach this point. In the next iteration, what will I do? I will put that value in the right hand side and again recalculate the left hand side. So, I have to somehow bring this value to here and then recalculate. And how do I bring this value to here? Simple. You go in the horizontal direction, meet here, and this will be that value. Okay. So, if this is my x 0, this will be my x 1, and then where will this one map? It will go to this point. Fine. Again, you have to bring this value to the x axis and go on calculating. How will you do that? Simple. Come horizontally to the 45-degree line, and this point is what x 2 is. How will you go on further? Again, go up to the graph of the map, you come here. Again, you go this way, again you go this way, again you go this way, again you go this way, so on and so forth. So, what actually are you doing? You are iterating the map. What I asked you to do by pressing a calculator, you can also do it by a computer, but a nice visualizable way of doing that is this way. Practice this, because this is a very important tool in our hands to understand the dynamics of systems. We can easily see whether or not a orbit will converge or not, or will it diverge. You can easily see. How? For example, if you have the graph of the map is like this, and you have got the 45-degree line like so. I have drawn it badly, not 45-degree, nevertheless, do not mind. Suppose you start from this initial condition, that means this initial condition, how will it go? And it will converge, right? It will converge. Just by doing this without really pressing a calculator, I could see that it is converging. But Can you see what would be the condition for convergence? That the slope here has to be less than 1. Let us prove it. When you are very close to this fixed point, you can more or less approximate by a straight line. Then you would say that I have, here is the 45 degree line, I have the graph of the map like so, enlarged. Then if I start from a point here, I will go up like this and you will go like this, and if it lands closer to the fixed point, then I know that I am homing onto it. I will go again, I will go again. If this distance is also closer than this distance, I know I am homing onto it. Now just apply simple trigonometry to check this condition that it will converge if this line's slope is less than 1. Check. You will essentially need to make sure that this distance is larger than this distance. But I leave it to you, it is too simple for me to do, it is trivial. By the way, if it is like this, then if this is the graph of the map, then if you start from a point somewhere here, right, some initial condition somewhere here, you will go to the graph of the map, you will go to the 45 degree line, again you will go to the 45 graph of the map, you will again go horizontal to the 45 degree line, again go to the graph, again go to the horizontal 45 degree line, and so on and so forth. Ultimately you can see that it is convergent. It is easier to check that in this condition than in this condition, so you can easily check that. Starting from here, how will it go? It will go to the graph of the map, graph of the map stops here, and then it will go to the 45 degree line, again to the graph of the map, to the 45 degree line, to the graph of the map, so it goes. So you see here the slope of the map was less than 45 degrees, less than plus 45 degrees, and here the slope of the map was less than or greater than minus 45 degrees. The modulus has to be less than unity, then only it will be stable. So just trace back your thoughts. We decided that the whole orbit, its stability can be understood by the studying only the character of the fixed point. If it is stable, then my whole orbit will be stable. Now you see we are homing on to a condition by which we can check the stability of the fixed point from the map, provided the map is 1D. I will come to the higher dimensional cases later. One dimension is easier to understand, so we did it for 1D first. Just before we break off, notice two things. One is this type, that it homes onto the fixed point from one side. It starts from this side, it remains this side. Starts from that side, it remains that side. While if it is like this, it goes on once to the left, then to the right, then to the left, then to the right, then to the left. This character we will again comment on in the next class. That's all for today.